Today we're going to be speaking about electromagnetic waves and more specifically how we emit or how we receive them. So what are the sources and how do we describe the sources of electromagnetic wave? It's something a bit more general than our previous discussion, because what we restricted ourselves to last time were free waves. So now we're going to be speaking about electromagnetic waves in general, so solutions to Maxwell's equations, wave solutions, not only in the vacuum, so not only in the lack of sources, but exactly close or, well, a relatively large distance away from the sources. So we are not interested in the free wave propagation, we're interested in how it is produced. And just looking at a few plots of the pointing vector, or its absolute value, like those I'm showing on this slide, you can immediately persuade yourselves that the general electromagnetic field is not as pretty and as easy to describe as it was for the free waves. So you see these very complicated looking patterns. Some of them have some symmetry in space. This may simplify the problem of finding them a little, but in general, these patterns are very, very hard to find, and an analytical expression for how a general source of waves is going to emit them, or otherwise how the power density will be distributed, the power flux will be distributed in space, it is a generally hard question to answer. And the reverse engineering of that, so how to create a source which gives you a specific power density in a specific direction, it's even harder to do. So there is a very interesting and very strong methodology which is adopted in this case, which allows us to analyze complicated electromagnetic fields by decomposing them. Before going to that, let's introduce a very strong mathematical tool known as the four potential. So those of you who may have had some physics classes may be familiar that in classical mechanics we introduce potentials to find forces. So a potential is somehow determining the force, either as its gradient or in some other way. So what we do in the electromagnetic field is we introduce potentials which are going to determine the fields themselves. So we introduce two potentials. One of them is a function or a scalar, and this is phi, and the other one is a vector. This is the potential called A. So we have one scalar potential and one vector potential, and the two of them, it turns out, we can always find a pair of them which can describe our fields. So we can always find a function phi and a vector A in such a way that the electric field is given in the following way, shown on the slide, and the magnetic field is given again with the same potential A in the following way. So what this decomposition in potential tells us, what this introduction of potentials tells us, is that the two fields, E and B, the physical fields which we know, can be given in terms of those, you may think of them as equally hard to find and to solve potentials, but the fact is that Maxwell's equations, which we showed previously, which we now know, are really simplified in terms of those potentials. Now, one important point to note before actually seeing Maxwell's equations is that these potentials are not uniquely determined. So these potentials are not unique in a sense that even if you just look at phi, since the electric field is determined by its gradient, if we add some random constant to phi, it will not change the field itself. It will only change the potential, but the electric field would be the same. Something similar happens for A if we add a gradient of a function, and so these two potentials, phi and A, they're not unique for a field configuration, but if we have them, the electromagnetic fields which we obtain are unique. And so if we had phi and A, we have unique electric and magnetic fields. Now, this freedom that is given to us by the fact that we do not have unique potentials actually allows us to simplify the problem of finding the fields a little by introducing what is known as gauge. Now, we will not be diving into these details at all, but what is important to notice is that since we have this freedom, we can pick our vector potential and our scalar potential in such a way that we get wave equations for both of them. So Maxwell's equations, if we substitute those expressions for E and B as a function of phi and A, so the electric and magnetic fields, as a function of the potentials, we're going to get the following two wave equations. One wave equation for the scalar potential and one for the vector potential. And you may be thinking that we somehow cheated because we had four Maxwell's equations and now Maxwell's equations are just two. Well, we did not cheat because the four equations we had before were of first order, while these two are of second order. So we reduce the number of equations, but we make them a little more complicated. So we raise the order of the derivatives. But this is actually not much of a complication, because it turns out that these two equations, these two wave equations for the vector field and for the scalar potential, can be integrated almost immediately, especially over a large field. There is a methodology known as Green functions, which you can learn a little more about in the supplementary material, but long story short, if we apply Green's functions, and if we use this strong methodology, we can immediately get a solution for those two potentials. So if we had the sources, that is the current density and the charge density, we can immediately find those two potentials in terms of them as rather complicated looking integrals. Now the real power of this methodology of these potentials is the way that we can actually approximate them. So you may be thinking that, okay, we have the real solution, we can solve these equations. Well, the answer is that in order to do that, we have to evaluate some very, very nasty integrals, which you're going to see in the supplementary material. So a very nice and very intuitive way to instead work with antennas is to actually define the multiple expansion. So what is this? Well, it's something very similar to what we did with our signals, with our sine waves, which we could decompose a general signal into sine waves. Something very similar, except that we're not decomposing into sines or cosines, we're decomposing into functions known as spherical harmonics. And these functions are a set of, or a basis of complete functions, which actually describe, if you like, everything you can think of on a sphere. So they are the natural basis on a sphere. And since our space is isotropic, that means if we specify direction by actually giving a point on a sphere, we can use these spherical harmonics to describe how the fields are, if you like, related depending on the direction we're looking at. So we can actually describe those complicated looking fields by expanding them in terms of the spherical harmonics. Now don't be scared about how the spherical harmonics may look. You can search them up. They're a complete set of functions. You can find information about them in any book on partial differential equations, for example. The general idea that we use is that this ratio, 1 divided by the radius vector, can be expanded very naturally and very nicely in terms of spherical harmonics. And so the complicated looking integrals which we get, which you will see in the supplementary material, they can be approximated as a sum of simpler integrals. So instead of solving one unsolvable integral, we expand it into a sum of many solvable integrals, and we can evaluate the first one, the second one, the third one, and so on, and we can actually get some accuracy, because each new one we evaluate adds some accuracy to our approximation. So instead of actually solving the full problem, we solve the problem to the degree which we need it. So we do not really need the full field for most applications, and in fact, in many cases, we only need the leading order correction. So our approach is actually exactly that. Not to solve the full problem, but to decompose the problem into simpler ones, and once having solved each of them, we can analyze universally in terms of them. Now those simpler fields, which are, if you like, the expansions of the general field, they are known as the multipoles, so the multipole fields. Now each one is a doubling of the previous one in terms of its name, so we have monopole, dipole, quadrupole, octopole, and so on. So we have a doubling, if you like, and they are actually described by the three parameters of the spherical harmonics. And so, for example, the zeroth term of the spherical harmonics is what gives us the monopole. The first function of the spherical harmonics, which is simply a constant, it has a constant on a sphere, simply a spherical wavefront. And this is the monopole, and this is what we have, this is the field that we get if we have a single charge. So if we had only a positive charge or only a negative charge, we're going to get this distribution of the potential. Now the second term is a dipole. So the next term actually breaks the spherical symmetry. We now have a cylindrical symmetry, and we have two droplets, if you like, which each of them, you can think of it as being two charges. So if we had just one charge, we have a sphere. If we had just another charge, we had another sphere. But if we have two of them together, they are sort of twisting towards each other, so they elongate on one side, since the field lines want to connect between the two of them. And you can think of the dipole configuration as exactly that, as a modification of the monopole twice, so two monopoles which are slightly modified. Now this philosophy actually goes on. You can in fact view the quadrupole as, in a sense, as two coupled dipoles and so on and so on. But the general idea is that we expand by some very simple configurations. So we describe the general hard to look at configuration in terms of the simpler ones. So in the case of the magnetic field, we have no monopole term, so we have no magnetic monopoles, what you may call. We have a dipole term, so the first one which we can get is a dipole field, and again, it has the same cylindrical symmetry, as you may call. This is what we would call a permanent magnet, in fact, the dipole configuration, and so on and so forth. And going further, you can see on the slide how the first few spherical harmonics look. And in fact, there is another number which specifies exactly the orientation of the spherical harmonics with respect to the spatial coordinates. But in general, the symmetry of each of these rows is the same. So we start from spherical symmetry, we go into a dipole symmetry, then quadrupole, and so on and so on. And the number of different nodes, if you like, in those functions increases with each new number. So the fields get more and more complicated. And when we add them up, when we add them together, you can see an example of this in this slide, we can actually form fields which are not part of the harmonics themselves. So a very similar idea emerges, like that we used for the general signals when we describe them by sine waves. So we added sine waves together in such a way that we formed the new signal which cannot be described by a simple sine wave. So we describe the general signal as a superposition of sine waves. And this is the same idea. So we have the spherical harmonics which we can add up together and which we can use in order to describe any conceivable configuration of the fields. And so you can see this example that we take actually a spherical harmonic which is simply the monopole, so a constant spherically symmetric function, and we add two more spherical harmonics and they have specific coefficients, and what we get when we add them together is this perhaps torus looking configuration on the left, which cannot be simply described by a single spherical harmonic. And this process, it may not end very quickly, so we may need to add an infinite number of spherical harmonics to get the real field, but the point is that the further we go, and this is the beauty of it, the further we go in terms of the spherical harmonics, so the higher the harmonic is, the faster it will recede with space. So the further we go, the less important it will be for the overall field. And this actually allows us to decompose in such a way that, depending on how far we are, if we go further or if we're very near the source, we can neglect a large number of these harmonics and only use the rest. So the three regimes, we're actually coming to this natural question, there are three regimes in which we can look at the general electromagnetic field and in the multiple expansion. So the first one is the near field, and this is when we're very close to the source. So if we're very close to what is emitting the waves, what is the difference with respect to the far field is that we see everything almost instantaneously. So recall that the electromagnetic field has a speed, so it's not infinitely fast propagating. It has the speed of light as its propagation speed. And so if something changes, generally it will take some time for us to feel it. So if an electron moves here, another electron will take some time for the wave to propagate to it, and only then will it understand that the first electron moved, in a sense. Now, if we're in the near field, the distances are so small, and since the speed of light is roughly 300,000 kilometers per second, actually you can neglect altogether the delay, and you can think of the field as changing instantaneously. Now, on the far field, things are exactly the opposite. So on the far field, we actually need to consider what happened in the past to the field configuration in order to know what to expect now. This is because, again, if we're very far away, then what we're seeing now is actually something which was emitted in the past, the same way that we're actually looking at the stars in the past, since the light from them takes a very long time to get to us. In a very similar way, when we're looking in the far field of the antenna, we're actually looking back in its past emission, and we're not seeing it as it is right now. So in the far field, there is a term which we're going to see very shortly, which actually tells us to look in the past of the sources. Now, the third point is the intermediate field. Unfortunately, we cannot make any approximations there, so you can see in the supplementary material how the far field and the near field actually simplify the equations due to the mathematical formalism of what actually far and near means with respect to the speed of light. But in the intermediate field, we cannot make such an approximation, and so essentially we need to try to solve the full problem. The good news is that in most cases we are concerned with the far field. So especially if we're dealing with antennas, especially if we care about something which should be emitted and we should receive it far away from the source, then we only care about the far field. And as perhaps as the most important conclusion of this lesson, this is what the far field looks for an expansion up to the second term in these spherical harmonics. So if you take this, if you do this expansion, if you find the potentials, and if you then follow the recipe with which you get the fields from the potentials, you're going to get the following electric and the following magnetic field for the far field. So what you see very naturally here is that the fields are now not constant, unlike the sine waves which we considered. They are going down, radially decreasing as 1 over r. And you can see that, as I promised, this p is the electric dipole moment and m is the magnetic dipole moment. And you can see that the field strength, or the electric and magnetic intensities, they depend on the dipole change, so the magnetic or the electric dipole change, in fact the second derivative, but at the previous time. So you can see that the function depends on t minus r over c, so time minus the distance traveled divided by the speed of light. So the time before we received this emission, so the time sometime in the past when this signal was emitted, but before we received it, since we received it only after this r over c, so distance over velocity, which it took the light to get to us. So these formulas are going to be our basic idea on analyzing the simplest possible antenna we can think of, the dipole antenna. And to get some more ideas on how to derive them, you should look at the supplementary material.